our jurisdiction into a context, right? Now, we have been talking about multiple things at multiple times. So while Hota sir was talking about the most social and cultural context of seeing business cooperation in India, my job is here to look at the legal context. All right, so I will not say it's an extension from Professor Hota's session, but it's an extension from Professor Harris's session. In the sense, where do we locate our jurisdiction in context to the larger developments that is going on? So we have been talking about transplant theory, we have been talking about convergences, divergences, different models of corporations, different varieties of companies in terms of whether you take US companies, whether you take European countries, whether you take the developing countries, say from South Africa or India, so Singapore. What I'm trying to say basically is just this, that if you look at these jurisdictions, and especially in context to the Indian jurisdiction, the answer to where we place ourselves is not so simple. One of the reasons being, and all right, a small request from my side, we are not having any presentation in this course, right, in this session. This session is not being evaluated on, isn't it? Close your laptops. Please close your laptops. As it is, most of you are not writing notes, isn't it? So this is Harris's lecture in this context. So we have been talking about mostly from the eyes of a corporation or business form as an Indian context. So my sessions basically is Evolution of Corporate Law in India. The title as such is I have taken from Professor Umakant's article, Evolution of Corporate Law in India from Transplant to Autochthony, one of the mandatory readings for this session if you have done. If you remember, in the company law course, we have also mentioned about this article as the very first article that we did. The context to this course basically is investigating, again, a context, investigating where we are placing our corporate law or our company law in picture. Now, it's fairly simple. In fact, it's very simplistic to say that it's purely transplant, that we have mimicked. So if you pick up any company law book today, it's basically in the first page of a company law book, you'll say the history of company law in India is basically copied from UK jurisdiction. But is it that simple to understand the mimicking of laws? Yes, we can say very simply that it's a cut, copy, paste. But have we diverged, and that's what the article investigates, right? Have we moved away from cut, copy, paste? Have we really not applied our mind, say, for example? And how does 1956 Act or, say, 2013 Act also play a picture in that? So if you look at 2013 Act, do we say that it's a cut, copy, paste of UK Companies Act 2006? To some extent, yes, because if you see the entire trajectory of the very forming of Companies Act in India, it every time there's a new Companies Act in UK, after 5 years, there's the Indian Companies Act. So in that context, yes, we have been copying. So Bhabha Committee is based on some committee, Cohen's Committee, say, for example. The Irani Committee is based, looks at the UK Companies Act of 2006. But again, yes, the references have been made, but have we moved ahead? Have we made our own customizations to that extent? And we have been doing this as in a large context in terms of trigger events, of different trigger events for that customization. So if you see the Companies Act, Companies Bill of 2008 and then 2009, when it went to the parliamentary committee, which was chaired by Yashwant Sinha, it was basically following, and I'm using this term for the first time again, as something that is called ESV context, shareholders, or mostly in the terms of seeing corporate form as something to advance the profits of the shareholders themselves. So there's no talk about stakeholders as such. But if you see the Companies Act in its final form, you find in section 166, right? And 166 not just says the duties of directors, in like we have understood, but it extends the duty of directors to employees, to creditors, to community, to environment. So does that mean that we have moved towards stakeholders theory rather than a shareholders, or in fact the maximization of profit theory. Can we make that context? Because if you compare, say, for example, see chapter section 170 to 177 of the UK Companies Act, and you will find there's a huge difference in the very phraseology of duties of directors in India and, say, in UK. While in UK, this connection to stakeholders, whether it's creditors, employees, or environment, it's subservient to duties of directors towards the company. In India, it creates as a own duty in itself, having a own right in itself. So it's not subservient to anything. What I'm trying to say basically is just this. Again, you have multiple examples from Indian Companies Act 2013, whether it's take the CSR provision, you take, say, for example, the RPT, say, for example, yes. Independent directors, say, for example, yeah. Yes, that's a valid question. Can they use Section 166 to fight for their own rights? So, for example, can members of the community and say that, look, the actions of the company is detrimental to the community at large? My answer is probably yes, because Section 166 has been drafted in such fashion. We have not seen cases in till date, but if you see the wordings of 166, there's no limitation to that. What I'm trying to say is, again, this, and I'll come back to in the context, and why I've used this picture as my introductory slide. It's important to read the statute in a context. The context which Professor Hota was talking about is slightly different context that I'm talking about. So I see, say, for example, a company law legislation as a product of trigger events, whether it's Satyam, which changed the course of that parliamentary committee when it was studying Companies Act 2009, whether it's Sahara, which changed the course of how we see Section 42, say, for example, whether private placement. So what I'm trying to say basically is this: you have to understand the historical context to understand why a law change, why a law is there. Because if I trace it back to Laporta's article, which talks about the connection between law and capital market, I will do the reverse analysis. And the reverse analysis is, now if you compare the Indian jurisdiction, what is the percentage of retail investment in stock market in India? What is the percentage of retail investors investing in the stock market in India? Or in other words, what part of the population of the country basically invest in stock market? It's minuscule, right? Minuscule investment, or at least the retail investors in the stock market. Now, why is that? So if I do a reverse analysis, the reason being is, again, you have had in history a lot of trigger events which have affected the confidence of the investors in stock market. So if you take the entire series of events that happened after the model liberalization or the opening of the market as such, you're hit back to back by events that jolted the very confidence of the investors on the stock market. And then it's not just happened in 1990s. If you look at the history, it's happened right in 1800s also, where we have been talking about systems which were slightly different from the present context in forms of managing agency system. So what I'm trying to say, I start my class basically on the fact that it's important. Again, it's not just look at the jurisdictions we have been inspired from, but look inward and try and understand what events have triggered that customization to happen. So it's not just that customization can be seen from a lens of, so the argument that is being made is that most of these jurisdictions which started with pure transplants, say for example India, where 1956 Act was a transplant, say for example of UK Companies Act 1948, Bhabha Committee did spend a lot of time in making those recommendations, report, Bhabha Committee report. But if you see that report, it's more than hundreds of references to UK Companies Act. What I'm trying to say is, that it's just not simple to say that we have copied and then diverged. What are the trigger events for that divergence to happen is equally important to understand the context of the section. So I will go take a step back again. So with that preliminary note, I'll take a step back and try and understand through those articles, obviously, that I sent, that how have we progressed in terms of Companies Act. Now, before we do that, now there was one team which was talking about managing agency system here. Yes. All right. Well, we'll come back. Come to you. Right. This is a book. This is cover page of a book by Gurcharan Das and Omkar Goswami, basically talking about a system that happened. And you will find multiple parallels with the diffused shareholding model that is in U.S. You can compare this with a present-day mutual fund. Also, I'll stress on the point how am I making that connection. But this is basically a small book with respect to. It says managing agencies and the making of corporate India. It talks about a system which prevailed in the early 1900s and the late 1800s, which talked about again how, to some extent, there was collaboration between the British investors and the Indian investors. So, for example, I used a picture later in the slide. Who is this? The team. Yeah, so I picked up this picture from one of the first joint ventures that happened. So this is by a person, the industrialist in Calcutta by the name Dwarkanath Tagore. And he, along with, again, another investor, William Carr, basically established a company by the name of Carr, Tagore and Company. And the function of that company, yes, that company did not survive for long, just survived for 10 years. But the very role of that company was to act as a managing agency. Now, so why are we not talking about managing the agency today? One of the reasons, yes, it got banned by the 1970 amendment to the Companies Act 1956, and it's no more there. But again, to what context do we study managing agency system? Do we study in the context of a precursor of a concentrated ownership? Do we study in the context of the initial red flags to corporate governance? Do we study in the context of a democratic decision making of the company? So in what context do we study this managing system? So I'll just, please close your laptops, not necessary today. Please close your laptops. Again, not necessary. Again, this class is not being evaluated upon, so not necessary to you take down notes. All right. I'll share these slides with you if you require, but I'll jump straight to my extension of the discussion we were having previous day. So in terms of models of ownership, we have been talking about basically largely two basic models, the Anglo-American market model and the concentrated ownership model. I mean, taking this from one of the slides of Sir, basically two models that we study, right? The American model is talking about more diffuse shareholding and primacy to shareholders' interest, emphasis on minority protection, high disclosure standard, and in contrast to it, the concentrated ownership model, which talks about cohesive form of insiders. Owners of shares can basically family interest converted into corporate structures, which again, the ownership and the management is intertwined with one another, right? So one who is the owner is also appointing the managers or is acting as managers to run the company. So primarily two models that we are talking about. And I'm not talking about the advantages or disadvantages of both the models. Both have their own advantages and disadvantages. I'm not saying concentration model is anything which is lesser than the diffused model. Because again, if you see, there's a reference in the Laporta's article which talks about he studies different jurisdictions and makes an analysis. Not more than 30% of jurisdictions have, or in fact, only 20-30% jurisdictions have a diffuse shareholder model. Rest are more tilted towards a concentrated shareholding model. So if you place this, understanding of two models, where do we find Indian companies or at what level? How do you see Indian companies fitting in one of the two models? Okay, why? So, which companies are we talking about? Are we talking about listed entities? Are we talking about public unlisted entities? Are we talking about private entities? Yeah, so general, if you see, again, so I picked up this data from a 2015 study. So if you see, and I'm just trying to place a context, where are we finding the Indian companies? So if you see the Indian companies, say, for example, in the first part, 100 trillion market capitalization, but if you see, on an average, this is from the listed companies listed on the Bombay Stock Exchange. Bombay Stock Exchange has how many companies? How many companies are listed in India? Roughly around the NSE and BSE, around? Both combined 7,000 companies. There's another, there was a speech by the finance minister in the parliament which said around 7,000 roughly. So you have more listing on the Bombay Stock Exchange, lesser listing on NSE, primarily because one is older than the other. But again, there are around 7,000 listed entities, around 66,000 public unlisted companies, and 10 lakh private companies. So it's important to place a context, right, that you have to understand the ownership pattern in mostly in Indian companies. And listed entities will indicate how the other companies fare. Because if you find a concentrated ownership in companies which are listed, again, you do not expect a diffuse shareholding in other types of companies. So we are looking at a pattern, or in fact, type of ownership. So there was a study done by IIM Bangalore also in terms of ownership pattern across the years. So you will find that if you see the left-hand side of the slide, the pie chart, it says 51% is your promoter shareholding, and an average 51% promoter shareholding is there, and then there's a diffusion of shareholding in form of your other market players. So on the top, you will find promoters, FIIs, DIIs, non-institutional, and others. We know what promoters are, right? We have no other understanding. Companies Act defines it, your ICDR defines it, and again, you will find references of promoter. Promoters primarily, we understand in terms of decision makers of the company. Right, so mostly the owners become a concentrated ownership in form of 51%. You will find the diffusion in the rest. In fact, so you will find 19% by your foreign institutional investors, your 10% by domestic DIS, domestic institutional investors. The rest 16 and 4% by others. Others basically depository receipts. Shares were held by custodians. So the diffusion in that form, again, and if you see and you pick out the float from here, market float is essentially the non-promoter shareholding, which is basically their liquid share that is there available in the market. Now, if you pick out that, again, you will find, and you will also realize how international market affects us. So if you have 40% by foreign institutional investors, then obviously happenings in the international market will affect the listed entities in India. Now, if I go forward again, if you see the growth, again, you will find a consistent pattern of concentrated ownership in at least the listed companies of Bombay Stock Exchange. You'll find a small dip here and there in the later part of around 2013-14. Why is there a dip in promoter shareholding around 2013-12? Because when somewhere around the line SEBI realized that I should pass a regulation, and they made an amendment to SCRR by saying not 90% or 95% state, but at least 3:1, 75-25. That is the prescribed norm by SEBI, right? We want certain diffusion to happen. If you don't want that diffusion to happen, please unlist. But SEBI, it was a top-down model where the SEBI said, we understand the benefits of a diffuse shareholding pattern, and thereby, promoters must liquefy their stake in the companies and bring it down to at least 75. Right, you can have less than 75, but at least 25% shareholding should be there. So you'll find certain dip there. But what largely I am saying, so if you, again, other slides are for your reference. Top 10 public shareholders in India, you'll find LIC as one of the major shareholders. LIC, again, in the list of your institutional investors, you call domestic institutional investor, and then top promoters of the company. Now, what exactly I'm trying to say? Now, if I have to place the Indian companies in a particular model, the natural E that I'll place the Indian companies is in the second model, the concentrated ownership model. Because as per the data suggests, and this data does not change for an NSC too, I picked up the data from BSC, but again, do not find much difference in the high ownership of the promoters in the listed entities. Now, so in terms of the models that we have, in the models that we have discussed, American, Anglo-American model or the concentrated ownership model, we are largely towards the concentrated ownership model. And from here we see, say for example, how, so it's important to place, you find a particular model, because you'll find all your sections, all your laws and regulations geared towards, what do you say, protection regime. When it creates a protection regime, it identifies the pattern of ownership in Indian companies and thereby places, say for example, the section of exec and non-exec directors, right? If you see the board of directors of a listed entity, there's certain percentage that is mandated by ICDR, not ICDR, but LODR, isn't it? LODR now, say for example, which talks about certain percentage of your board of directors from non-exec or certain percentage to be independent directors. Because you realize that, say for example, you have a model or you have a pattern of ownership where you require those independent directors to be on board. And I'm not going to the very effectiveness of those people on the board, but because even if you have independent directors, you can have cases like Sahara and Satyam, right? That can happen. But again, you will realize the demerits of that system again, because when the directors are appointed at the mercy of concentrated ownership promoters, then they will work according to the whims and fancies of your director or the controlling shareholders again. But again, so I wanted to start this class basically in terms of placing ourselves into one of those models of ownership where data suggests that we have again concentrated ownership, because your tracing of the law will keep coming back to this model. Whether you talk about RPTs, related party transactions, we talk about corporate governance norms, whether you talk about so RPT is basically derived from your OECD paper, which talks about concentrated ownership or concentrated wealth in a few hands, and derived from that paper, your RPT provision comes out and say that, look, again, you talk about board governance, say for example, board of directors, you talk about layers of subsidiaries that you're allowed, say for example, how many layers are allowed? So you talk about layering, you talk about board decision, you talk about related party transactions, you talk about inter-corporate deposit, inter-corporate loans, all is derived from understanding and very clear understanding of the term that, look, we are from a particular, there's certain types of companies that we have. And if you want to address the issues of investor protection, we have to create norms around it. I have marked out a few papers for you again. There's an IM paper by N. Balasubramaniam which traces the pattern of ownership across Indian companies in a particular stock exchange. And then you have the tracing of corporate governance norms on the basis of concentrated ownership by Jayati Sarkar. All right, so let's start. So for this class, basically, I picked on a few papers for discussion. So the primary base of this discussion will be Professor Umakant's article. Again, Professor Umakant, we have been studying Professor Umakant's article in our classes. So one of these articles is Evolution of Corporate Law in India, From Transplant to Autochthony, 2016. Then again, one of the readings that was done by the team, Corporate Law in Colonial in India, Rise and Demise of Managing Agency System. So one will feed into the other, basically. One is a subset of the other. Then there's a 1979 quite famous article by Robert C. Rosen, Myth of Self-Regulation. And this was written at a time, again, the year is 1979. We are into that phase where we are neither very market friendly nor very 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 conservative. So we are still fighting in the regime of whether to go for socialism, whether to go for market-oriented or understanding the importance of private capital. So we are still in the debate of Nehru and Patel in that era. So 1979, he writes an article based on the situation that was there in India. Right, so he had a series of public meetings with different officers, and he writes a paper on myth of self-regulation by saying you cannot have a regime which will lead to a robust capital market unless you have the environment to do so. Right, so unless the political will, say one of those criteria, and you have the resources in terms of a very robust system to implement those laws or regulation, it will be meaningless in terms of protection that you want to provide. So he talks about myth of self-regulation or the dangers of securities regulation without administration, the Indian experience. This has substantially changed now. Right, we are talking about a time, say for example, where in 1947 we created the CCI, Controller of Capital Issues, 1947, but that again took 50 years, but again we created SEBI Act and we transformed the very ideology of a regulator. So you'll find Companies Act having an inspiration from UK, while the regulator having an inspiration from US. So SEBI derives its inspiration from SEC, and if you see the preamble of SEBI Act, it says development and then regulation. So it's not based on the premise of CCI, but in a very different context. You have to see that article, 1979 article, and try and place this in the present day context, whether the argument that is making 1979 still holds good today. Then there's another article in this book, Stakeholder Approach to Corporate Law, where the argument basically is whether we have been oscillating between shareholder and stakeholder model, whether the reference to, or in fact the inclusion of some certain provision in the Companies Act is just a sprinkling of fanciful inclusion, and largely we are shareholder model, and trying to investigate on that aspect. And finally, this is a cross-country comparison of corporate laws across jurisdictions. India is one of that in the table. Good paper to read with respect to understanding of these articles. Now, as I said, again, if you see the last paper, this starts with basically continuation from the earlier classes. What is corporate law? Again, I'll go back to the very old question. What is law? Now, my question, what is corporate law? Do we understand corporate law as just company law or securities market law? Or do we understand corporate law in more of having a holistic picture of, so if a company say, is during its lifetime, it's being affected, say for example, SEBI capital market regulation, the Companies Act, but do we see corporate law in that context? Or do we see companies' existence being guided by other laws also? Say banking laws, say for example, say foreign exchange laws. So do we see corporate law as a small circle or a bigger circle is the first question that we have to understand. Because I'm going back to the same reverse analysis, that if I'm making that argument that retail investors do not invest in India, and try and find out the reasons for it, one of the prime reasons that come out is the lack of public confidence. And when you say lack of public confidence and try and trace the reasons for it, you will find a series of trigger events that have caused that public sentiment. So in the last 15, 20 years, I can list out 15, 20 events that have a very negative impact on the sentiment of public shareholders or the retail investors in the stock market. Now, if we trace it back again, why did those trigger events happen? I will trace it back to the wheat regulations that operated on those companies which initiated that fraud or scam, right? So if I drew a reverse kind of pathway, then to get a healthy capital market, a robust capital market, you have to work on the public confidence. To work on the public confidence, you have to prevent those trigger events to happen. To prevent those trigger events to happen, you will have to have robust laws in picture or regulation in pictures which preempt those events. Unless you have those regulations which preempt those events, then you will not be able to create that public confidence, because you will not be able to stop those events. So what I'm trying to say basically is just this, that your laws basically, and that is where this word of flexibility and your rigidity continuum has to be there, that you have to create a system, say for example, which addresses the scenario where the ultimate objective is to have a healthy or a robust capital market. Now, we are talking about convergence and divergence, and basically two lines that I picked up in form of shareholder value as the overriding goal for corporate governance, or is bound to be accepted by most jurisdictions, or the divergence theory. Countries will continue to diverge even under pressures of global competition for capital. Corporate law is the only one element in complex institutional structure. Different countries follow different idiosyncratic paths of institutional change. Now, if we see again, tracing back to Indian context again, do we see symbols or signs of convergence, or do we see signs of divergence in the Indian context? Again, the answer is not so simple. If you see different legislations, we have been inspired, again, I'll use the word inspired rather than copied, but again, since we started with transplant, yes, so 1956 Act is a clear inspired version of your UK Companies Act 1948. And that is what, I'll come back to this argument, but I'll just go to this slide first, where Professor Omar Khan basically looks at 1950, the phase of 1850-1947 as a phase and the events leading to 1956 Act. And he terms basically, and if you see the argument, 1956 Act as a puzzle. The reason it was a puzzle, because it was something, 1956 Act was created in an environment which was socialist, but we created an act by the Bhava Committee Act, recommended an act which was most aligned towards your UK developments, more market-oriented developments. So, and you will, and that is the reason you will find a series of amendments that have happened after 1956, because you wanted to then bring Companies Act in alignment to your political thought, because you thought Companies Act 1956 gave too much flexibility to the companies in terms of their operation. And that is why, to bring them back again into the fold of political thought at that time, there was a series of amendments that was being made. So 1956 Act was followed by a series of amendments, and that is where the divergence happened. So the convergence in terms of, so yes, we started with a true and pure transplant. We soon after we diverged in terms of in terms of accepting the realities of the present context. And when I'm saying realities, again, I'll come back to the event that happened before 1950 to 1947, in the phase of 1850 to 1947, and I'm not going to the context of historical events that happened. I'll just use a few things from there. Now, if you see, say for example, and this we all know, right? If you see the Companies Act development in India, and because this we have discussed multiple times, so if you compare English Companies Act and Indian Companies Act, 1844, 1850, 1955, 1857, 1862, 1866, 1862, 1882, 1908, 1913, in the sense, give it 5 years, 6 years of time, company law in India will change as per the UK Companies Act. Now you will find the first kind of customization that happened here around this companies. So while new Companies Act came in UK in 1929, we did not go for a new act. We created amendments within the earlier act that was there. So it's called Companies Amendment Act 1936, and it recognized for the first time a system that was unique to India. And the first signs of customization, not a true transplant, where there's recognized the fact that there's something that is called managing system that is happening in India, not there in other jurisdictions, probably Singapore, probably Malaysia, because again, similar situated countries. But this is not there, which is something there in UK, and thereby we must address this. Address this, because there was a lot of UN cry that your Companies Act does not address the abuse of a managing agency system. But what exactly is a managing agency system? What is a managing agency system? Team.
they were Indian companies, and those Indian companies were overtaken by the British agencies. Now, in those companies, they were shareholders, but now the British people, what they did, that they appointed a managing agent. Now, these agents had a very little interest in the company, but the entire conception of managing agency was devised in order to make the, like, eliminate the informational asymmetry which existed at that point of time. Moreover, there were some geographical conditions. For example, the eastern parts of India, the eastern parts of India was very good in jute trade, and there were many parts of India which were commonly known for a particular type of trade. Now, these agents, they provided a platform between the British traders and the Indian companies, and that's why the managing agent system was really important. But after it, what happened that these managing agency systems, they worked for their own interest and not for the interest of the shareholder. That is why the entire conception of managing agency system became problematic.
Right. Thank you. What exactly is though? What is the managing agency system? It's a very interesting phenomenon. That is why that picture came into my mind. Dwarkanath, Tagore, William Carr and Company, Calcutta Steam Tug Association, first company of a joint venture between two industries, one from Britain, one from India. But what exactly is it? It says, ye lo meri company, tum chalao. As simple as that. In a sense that I am not interested in running the company, one of those reasons I'm just highlighting. I am not interested in running this company. This company has multiple shareholders. I'm not tracing the history of corporate personality, limited liability, all has come in. All right, so your Limited Liability Act has come in, your corporate personality, corporation, registration, all is there somewhere. What I'm trying to say basically is just this. Imagine this as a company and with multiple shareholders of the company, and the multiple shareholders of the company are saying, look, we are not interested in running this company. Why not give the operation part of the company to someone else? A expert, a manager, a monitor, whatever you call it, and that will run the company. That manager can be appointed on the basis of, look, I'm not interested, or say, I need an expert. Right? So, and that is why he makes a reference to two business places in India. One is the Bombay Ahmedabad region, and one is the Calcutta region. Well, Calcutta region is mostly around your jute industry is there in Calcutta. What else? Cash crops are there, jute is there. Now, these had to be exported, right? The prime capital that was coming from these companies was the export part. Now, if I am an Indian shareholder or if I am the promoter of this company, I do not have connections with external buyer to send these products outside. Probably that Britisher or that person who is an expert, can be an Indian also, who is an expert in foreign trade may make more profits than me. So I appoint a person / a partnership / a company to manage my company. So I'm saying basically that managing partner, that person that whom I'm assigning the role of managing the company, can be a simple proprietor, can be a partnership in its own form, or it can be a company running for profit. So basically the activity of that managing company is to manage other companies. The reason it developed more in the Calcutta region is because the Bombay region was already having seen traders from the Marwari and the Gujarati community. They did not need expertise. They were already expert in their business, and primarily because the region was mostly seeing textile industry, which was more and basically the trade in cotton or textile basically did not require such kind of expertise, because these community does not require those expertise. You will find in history that the Marwari community basically makes an entrance in the Calcutta region and gives strong competition to the British managing agents also. What I'm trying to say is just this. So when we understand managing agency system, basically we are saying that, look, there's a third person whom the role has been assigned to, who will take care of the functioning of the company. Now in this, so basically I'm entering into contract basically with a third party, and imagine this in the form of a mutual, in very vague terms, mutual fund. Why do we invest in mutual fund? Right? The reason we invest in mutual fund, because look, we are not expert in capital market. We are not expert in stock market, and thereby we want a third party to invest my money. I want my profits only. And the mutual fund company asked that, look, these are the avenues, gilt, short term, long term, government, banking, whatever you want to, these are the options. Depending on your wishes, we will invest, but you lose control over the very application of that money. That money goes to a pool, pool is invested somewhere, right? So in a, draw a vague connection to it, and in a similar fashion, look, this is a third party agency which takes care of the functioning of the company. Right? This is happening through a contract. Now what happened eventually, it started with a very fruitful exercise in terms of appointment of experts, but what happened eventually was, again, like any system, this managing agency was not restricted to my company alone. It had a pool of companies. So again, instead of working for the benefits, but please remember, this managing agent has a pool of companies from which he will derive its interest. But the shareholders of a particular company will derive interest from that particular company, right? It does not depend on the profit that the other company in his pool is making money or not. So what I'm trying to say basically is multiple things plague the entire system. Firstly, these managing agents, which came out to be mostly dominated by British or Englishmen than the Indian managing agents, started working for their own personal interest. In fact, for the proprietors or the managing agents' interest, in disregard to the interest of the shareholders of the company. Why did that happen? That happened because of the unique peculiarity of the contract they entered into. So the contract was generally, and the few things that I mentioned in the slide, so say for example, in the very tenure of that contract, for termination, strict termination of that contract. So the contract was essentially for 30, 40 years. So long duration contracts, strict, strict provisions for termination of contract. You had strong incentive mechanism. So for the manager agency to derive interest was based either on, say, turnover of the company or the profit of the company or the commission based on the sale of products or goods or services. Now, what I'm trying to say basically is that if you see the Companies Act 1936 here, the first customization that was made, again, in that context, was recognizing the fact that the managing agencies have not been running properly. The diffuse shareholding, and you will find most, the general pattern across all managed companies is a diffuse shareholding. All right, it's not concentrated ownership. So generally, you will find these managing agents holding 10 to 15% in the company, not more than that, but a small ownership in the company itself. But since they held strong ownership, a small ownership in the company and the rest of the shareholding was diffused, they were able to manage, in fact, exercise complete control on the decision making of the company. And again, the decisions were taken not catered towards their interest rather than the interest of the shareholders themselves. And while the termination was difficult, the shareholders had no recourse. No recourse because the law was not recognizing it at all. Because since you were mimicking the Companies Act of UK, you did not place regard to the system that prevailed at that in your jurisdiction. And that is why after hue and cry in the 1936, they made a certain amendment to the Companies Act 1913 and said there are few things that they laid out in terms of fixing the tenure of managing agents, in terms of, there's a whole chapter that they include by saying, this are the situation in which you can terminate the contract. So breach of trust, say for example, expropriation was some of the terms that have been used in that in that amendment. So just a small point that I missed with respect to role of board of directors. So while the requirement of board of directors was introduced in 1913, you will find in all these managed companies, while they were managers, the board of directors was just symbolic. In the sense, the directors were generally appointed by contacts with the managing agents themselves. So managing agents appointed people who had symbolic value. So you will find many companies which have directors who are rajas, Rai Bahadurs, all that appointed on board of directors, who had absolutely no interest in the functioning of the company, but the company derived interest by because it had a own reputational value also. So when a Raja or a Rai Bahadur say or a Zamindar is on the board of directors, again, it caters to the building of the public trust that is required for the company to generate capital. What I'm saying essentially is just this. That yes, we started with a pure transplant, and you will see the initial Companies Act going towards pure transplants of mimicking the laws from UK. 1936 was probably the first instance, and you will find a paper absolutely that Gurcharan Das book on managing agency system, or the paper on managing agency system is highlighting towards that point. Why did that customization happen? In 1936, that customization happened because it reached at a point where the Indian shareholders were not happy. And they asked, in fact, the representatives basically to put in that chapter of some say, of allowing some say for the shareholders in the managed companies. You will find, and strangely, and that's why I use the puzzling exercise, the 1956 Act, though refers to the abuse of managing agency system, does not stop it. The Bhabha Committee basically mentions that we understand the potential of a managing agency system to tap private capital or to cater to those companies which are not able to manage themselves. So the Bhabha Committee did see the positive side of managing agent system and thereby did not completely prohibit or restrict it. However, that did not stop the abuse because they did not address in the 1956 Act, because that was again mimicked from the UK Companies Act of 1948. So while the law did not respond, the abuse continued in the form. So yes, after the independence, the British, and that is why you will find the continuation of these British managing agency companies in India even after independence. Yes, they collaborated more with their Indian counterparts, but they continued. It was not a complete stoppage. However, when the law did not respond, finally, and the abuse continued, 1970 amendment to 1956 Act basically put a stop to the managing agency system. And we do not have that system anymore. But you will find these managing agents, in most cases, these managing agents later, when the managers acquiring more and more shareholding in the company they managed. All right, and what I'm trying to say basically is just this. I'll not go into more details with respect to that paper. What I'm trying to say is just this. So what the article starts with, and if you see the title of the article, from transplant to autochthony, what is autochthony? Autochthony is basically indigenous, right? From transplant, cut copy, to autochthony, something which is customized, indigenous, from the soil. So when you're saying from the soil, what are the trigger events from the soils to happen? And that one, so when I'm saying the first instance of autochthony happened in 1936, from managing agency system problems were the triggers for that autochthony to happen. And that became more prominent in the phase after 1956. It did not happen with the Bhabha Committee, but happened after that. And that is why that slide, I mentioned few books in the slide, so you can refer to that. So this is not Maris, this is Maria Misra, Business, Race and Politics in British India, basically traces the managing and system capitalization. All right, so if you see post 1956, and I'm using 1956 as the reference point, because Companies Act, Real Companies Act post independence came in the 1956 Act. What happened also in 1956, if you remember? Which big statute came, which is still there? SCRA came into picture. Securities Contract Regulation Act. If you trace the history of Securities Contract Regulation Act, you'll go to Bombay Stock Exchange, the native Bombay Stock Brokers Association, and even before that. What did SCRA did, in fact? SCRA basically was an act for the recognition of stock exchange, number one, and second, for preventing undesirable transaction in securities, right? But again, if you see the mismatch in the companies at SCRA was very, in that sense, prevented certain transactions. So derivative contract was not there at that time. Speculative contract, they wanted to put in. So what I'm trying to say again is simply this. If you see the 1960 to 1991, while some laws did exhibit the sentiment of that dispensation. The Companies Act saw that through amendments. So if you see that phase, infusion of socialist ideals, back-to-back amendments, departure from previous market-oriented light-touch regulations, I have mentioned a few things, and you can go back and refer to it. And we still refer to this, the concept of deemed public companies. Say, for example, what is something in between? While the UK Companies Act had a strict demarcation between private and public, we introduced a concept of deemed public companies. In the sense, certain companies which have more than certain amount of turnover of this will be deemed to be public companies. There's a third category that we created. Created a lot of trouble after that. That is, I'm not going to that. We eventually deleted that that clause in itself. Still creating a problem when we study about your foreign subsidiaries, but I'm not going to that. You find MRTP 1969 coming to picture. You find FERA 1973 coming to picture. Now FERA again. Remember the Needle Industries case, operation mismanagement case? Now FERA basically said that the foreign holding cannot have more than 40% stake in an Indian company, right? Just highlighting, say for example, whether it's MRTP, Monopolies Restrictive Trade Practices Act, yes. But what did it exactly do? MTP and RTP, right? Monopolies Trade Practices Prevention, Restrictive Trade Practices Prevention. UTP came in 1986. The Unfair Trade Practices part came in UTP also is there. 1986 got transferred to the Consumer Protection Forum. What I'm trying to say basically is that if you see the surrounding environment around Companies Act, not just the Companies Act, securities law, competition law of that era, FERA, say for example, Foreign Exchange Regulation Act, were all catering to the ideologies that the government had at that point of time, which was more of a state control. So you will find Control of Capital Issues 1947 catering towards when should the company come to capital market for raising capital, what amount it should raise capital, at what rate it should raise capital upon. It was all decided by the regulator. So this was a phase, say for example, which saw again triggered amendments in the Companies Act 1956 also. Now if you see the court rulings, and I'll connect this again, this is very important quote from the Supreme Court order of 1983, says the adoption of socialist pattern of society as the ultimate goal of the country's economic and social policies hastened the emergence of this new concept of the corporation. But one thing is certain, that the old 90th century view, which regarded a company merely as a legal device adopted by shareholders for carrying on trade on business as proprietors, has been discarded, and a company is now looked upon as a socio-economic institution wielding economic power and influencing the life of people. So are we looking at movement from shareholder to stakeholder again? Recognizing the fact that the company operates in a society and the actions of the company should take into account all the stakeholders, employees, creditors, community, environment, section 166. Did Supreme Court indicate towards divergence from the UK understanding of seeing company from a contractarian theory or a nexus of contracts theory to a more stakeholders theory? What are the two competing theories? One theory is saying that the prime objective and the only objective of the company is to increase the value of the shareholders, right? Shareholders enhancement value, or ESV model. The other theory is saying that while you take decision, you must take into account that the company is placed in a society and affects the interest of all stakeholders. So the two, and one is not placing one over the other, like section 172 of the UK Companies Act is doing. It's keeping the interest of the stakeholders subservient to the interest of the shareholders. If you really see 172 of the UK Companies Act, 166 is not doing that. I'll come back to 166 again, but again, if you see 1983 and the era at that point of time, can you say that we are moving ahead, diverging from a shareholder's perspective to a stakeholder's perspective? So as soon as you bring concepts like life of the people, public interest, stakeholders, employees, are we moving in that direction? So 1960 to 1991, You can say we have a touch or certain elements of sprinkling of stakeholders here and there in terms of, you will find in the Companies Act provisions for protection of creditors, provisions, say for example, taking account of the employee, say for example, in case of winding up, in case, say for example, where stakeholders have been taken into account. But if we, again, if you refer to the next phase, 1991 again to 2013, I'll come back to Companies Act 2013 again. Has the convergence again happened? And that is why what I was referring through a question in the previous class, that it is not so simple to trace a convergence line or a simple divergence line. It depends on the political, social, economic condition of that jurisdiction at that point of time, whether convergence or divergence will happen. So we are looking for a very myopic view of corporate law, and I'm started with what is corporate law, and we are looking for a very myopic view because we have to take into account other factors, say for example, for appreciating whether there's a convergence or divergence. But strictly from this view, while 1956 was more of a convergence of market-oriented regulation, the phase that followed was divergence in terms of aligning with the socio-economic context of that particular point of time and suiting other, say for example, the statutes that were created. But when we are forced again, 1990s, where our foreign capital depleted, where and we were forced to open the economy, did we converge again? Did we say again that we have to abandon these ideas now and align ourselves more with the international happenings or international developments? So the era 1990, say for example, and what are things that have started happening now? So you have a new regulator in the securities market in 1988, statutory power 1992, which says, look, development is my role, regulation is not my, regulations I'm second. You see the preamble itself. MRTP gets repealed, 2002 Competition Act comes into picture, which says all you have to do is not engage in anti-competitive behavior. We are not interested in whether you what your activities are, but anti-competitive behavior should not be there. And in terms of merger regulation also, basically say not all mergers need to be notified, but all those mergers and amalgamations which will have an anti-competitive effect will have to be notified. Right? So we are moving in a direction again which is converging with the jurisdictions which have more market-oriented regulation. Yes, the context is what? Context is we are forced to do that. We can no more carry on the socialist principles and then still satisfy the terms of our loans that we took from the international market. So you will find, say for example, what are the things that come in? So I'll just sprinkled right, for your reference. These are not exhaustive, just illustrative. So look at the kind of starting point that we have. So say for example, DVR, we understand what DVR is, right? I'm not going to that. Differential voting rights. So again, it's a fascinating thing to write a paper on, and again, the historical evolution of shareholders' right in terms of voting, whether it's democratic, whether it's plutocratic, whether it's DVR or differential. So democratic is basically one shareholder, one vote, isn't it? Plutocratic is one share, one vote, and DVR is another something else. We are still struggling to find out what that means. But again, their jurisdictions say, for example, so DVR came into picture in 2000, right? Yes, it has not developed as a in the market in Indian context, but we did allow DVR through a 2000 amendment. Say, for example, buyback provisions were brought in, where the companies were allowed to buy back shares from in a certain context. Yes, there are obviously restrictions put in place, but again, you will find what I'm trying to say is just this again. Summarize. You'll see the slide and you'll find, again, this phase brings in multiple areas that have been worked upon for that convergence to happen again. So you'll find amendments in Companies Act, you'll find SEBI Act inspired by SEC coming to picture, you'll find the CCI coming to picture, you'll find FEMA coming to picture rather than FERA. And again, even in your corporate governance measures. Now, India is one of those jurisdictions where the corporate governance norm was not started from a top-down model. It was got initiated from the industry itself. So you'll find, say, for example, the CII report of 1998, Confederation of Indian Industries 1998, which talked about corporate as a voluntary guideline. That gets adopted by many companies, but where is the inspiration coming from again? The inspiration is coming from the Cadbury Committee of UK. The corporate governance code in itself, it gets followed by Kumar Mangalam Committee report in 2000. Clause 49 is an example for that. SCRR gets amendment. Listing agreement gets amendment. Clause 49 gets included. Presently, LODR. I'm not going to the present corporate governance committee reports. But again, if you see Transformation Companies Act, corporate governance measures, other statutes, you'll find a certain convergence to happen again. Now coming to 2013 Act, and I'll move to other things again. Coming to 2013 Act, where do we place 2013 Act? Now 2013 Act, again, if you see, the Irani Committee gets created in 2004, right? Summit's report in 2000, gets created in Companies Bill 2008, bill gets lapsed. January 2009, there's a Satyam scam. Right, and the 2009 bill that is reintroduced again does not make a reference to all the changed scenario after post Satyam, but when it's referred to Parliamentary Standing Committee of Yashwant Sinha and that report is submitted in 2010, we'll find the impact of Satyam on that report, on the new companies bill. So you will find a high standard for gatekeepers, say for example auditors or your independent directors. And a policy shift, and some say policy shift, some say again is just a sprinkling of movement from the shareholder to the stakeholder theory, and mostly derived from Section 166 of the Companies Act, which is talking about environment, community, employees. How does that pan out? Again, is a thing to be seen. Because presently, you will, it's mostly, see again, if you, it's very interesting. Companies Act 2013 gets created, gets passed in the parliament, and soon after, how many amendments have you already seen? So and the first set of amendments that happened was that private companies, they blurred the distinction between private and public companies in the initial draft, in the original Companies 2013 Act. And then they passed a set of amendments which have brought back the flexibilities that were provided to private companies in the 1956 Act. So again, is it my basic worry, again, I'm coming back to the same argument, is it so simple to place a particular statute in a model? Because you will find jurisdictions like India, jurisdictions like Singapore, say Malaysia, where multiple factors have affected those laws and regulations. We started with transplant, and that is why, in some context, I agree with Professor Makand in terms of a talk thani. We started with transplant, and we moved to diverged models of corporation law based on our own customizations. And that is where autochthony is coming, the customization is coming. But again, you'll find time and again, the market realities kick in, and we move towards that direction. And basically, it picks up certain key issues in terms of, are you with me till now? All right. Please don't sleep. All right, so I picked up a few issues. I didn't know what extent should I pick up those issues. But again, if you pick up issues like, say, for example, the very structure of the company today in 2013 Act, and you will find multiple issues to work on in terms of their entire historical context. Right, say for example, right from lifting a corporate veil. So corporate personality, limited liability, and lifting a corporate veil. So in terms of judicial opinions, there's a whole divergence of opinions we will find. Everyone refers to Salomon versus Salomon, that's not a problem. We start at the context of Salomon versus Salomon, but whether we go into direction of Press versus Petrodel, or we go into direction of other strict interpretations of, not strict interpretation, but very wide interpretation of lifting corporate veil done by India. where they have lifted the corporate veil on the premise of public interest also. So the two countries, on a very small concept of lifting corporate veil, had diverged to a large extent in terms of appreciating what factors. So if you see Press versus Petrodel, we have done this class, TS in class, right? Lord Sumption's opinion, which talks about on what parameters, on what factors, evasion principle and your what? What is the second principle? Evasion principle and? All done, right? Evasion and concealment, yeah? Concealment principle, evasion principles, Lord Sumption, Press versus Petrodel, family law case, having implication in corporate law. Anyways, chodo. Air India case. Anyways, coming back. So what I'm trying to say, small issues, lifting corporate veil. Say, for example, the UV doctrine, ultra-vires doctrine. How we have done cases after cases of how Indian courts have interpreted ultra-vires doctrine and how the other courts have interpreted. Other jurisdiction have moved to a situation where there's no requirement of an object clause, right? But we there's still implication of object clause in 2013 Act, right? Have we deleted 2013 object clause from the 2013 Act? There was a proposal for it, but we haven't, right? But again, does that UV doctrine make any sense today? Probably not. It's an illusory concept that we have talked about. That ultra-vires doctrine in itself has lost its relevance because of the profusion of objects within the object clause of the memorandum. However, what I'm trying to say is, pick up any issues. You'll find in judicial opinion also, fitting to the customizing itself to the needs or the understanding of that era or that period. So you will find Indian courts more liberal or more flexible towards, say, lifting a corporate veil. They lift the corporate veil time and again. Right? But UK courts, say, for example, are more cautious towards lifting of that corporate veil. So concepts like ultra-vires doctrine, lifting of corporate veil, the very understanding of, say, for example, par value of shares. Many jurisdictions, the par value of shares has lost its relevance. Does not mean it makes any sense. But again, Indian law still emphasizes on a par value of shares. What I'm trying to say basically is pick up any issue. All right, and move ahead from this. Right. So basically, if I come back to this slide again, what exactly is this class all about? What I've been talking about again is a few ideas that we picked up from Professor Harris's course in terms of placement of a particular model of particular jurisdiction, a particular model. So we started with the idea of how different models exist in terms of the very structure of the companies, how different models have shaped the company or corporate legislation across the world, whether how, say, for example, the very concept of nexus of the divergence of nexus of contracts theory or contractarian theory, say, for example, is different from a stakeholders theory, and how different theories have at different times shaped corporate law, company law jurisdictions. What I'm coming to basically again is if you pick up these papers, one paper will feed into the other. I'll impress upon you to please go back, have a cursory look at those papers. All are available online or on HAIN online if you find them. So basically what I'm saying is, if you pick up the first paper as the base, the evolution of corporate law in India, use these articles, corporate law in colonial, the managing agency system, the stakeholder approach to corporate law in terms of analyzing its development in Indian context, and feed into the first paper. This paper, Catherine Pister's paper, is basically around tracing the history of, or in fact, evolution of corporate law across jurisdictions, like Laporta did, on multiple parameters. Right, any questions? Any questions? I'm done with my part. So if you don't have any questions, I will ask questions.
Sir, although I have not studied company law myself, but still based on this one question I have is, what is the present position exactly right now, like after the most recent amendments, whether we are converging or diverging?
As I said, it's not that simple to answer. So you will find Companies Act 2013. So I use this example in the capital market class also. So we have seen a set rules and regulations not as a precursor of an event, but a successor of an event. So companies law, or say for example securities law regulations, have been premised on the fact of certain events that have happened. So while corporate scams that happened in 1990s basically shaped how SEBI regulations were created in terms of market manipulation, front running, PFUTP regulations, say for example. In a similar way, Companies Act has been shaped by multiple events that happened before or during the Companies Act while it was being discussed. So Satyam is one, Sahara is another, Kingfisher is another. You will find the impact of these localized events. Now, I'm making a small point here. So these events probably might have happened because of loophole in the corporate law or in the adjoining, on the larger corporate laws. So probably a loophole in the banking law, probably loophole in the foreign exchange laws, probably loophole in other sectors that have again shaped corporate law of India. In the same breath, I am saying that you will find obviously convergence to happen on broader principles. So in a country like India, say for example, I use this, using this example in the previous class also. So concepts, smaller concepts like the differential voting rights, say for example, one share is equal to not one vote, but higher vote, say for example, superior voting rights. One of the reasons why Jack Ma took Alibaba to US was because that jurisdiction did not allow DVRs to happen. And as soon as Jack Ma went there, China, say for example, the Hong Kong or Singapore or other jurisdictions started debating around whether we should be allowing DVRs to happen or not. Because if you do not allow that, companies like Alibaba will move out from your jurisdiction to another jurisdiction. And thereby, it's not just internal event, but external events in the international market is triggering change in your laws. Singapore had a committee, say for example, which recommended a change in the DVR laws and allowed companies to issue superior voting rights. So what I'm trying to say is simply this, that unlike Western jurisdictions, the UK and US, the developing nations, the framing of the laws is influenced by multiple factors. And sometimes we'll find a convergence where we have to align with a particular principle or a framework. So the corporate governance norms, you'll find a larger alignment there. Competition law, say for example, you will find a larger alignment there. You have organizations, say for example, which are working towards that alignment. So in securities market, you have IOSCO, so for example. You have international competition network in competition law field which is working towards alignment. So these jurisdictions are also influenced of that, so you'll find convergence in those broad ideas, but there is divergence where we have to suit our own problems or to answer to our own loopholes that is existing. So while we have a convergence on the broader principles, small nitty-gritties, we will have customizations to happen, right? So to say whether it's convergence or divergence, I do not have an answer. It is both in, to some extent. Some provisions are specifically created in the Indian, say, Companies Act to suit or to answer to the problems that we had before. So, for example, class action suit is an answer to our embarrassment, say, for example, where the shareholders in US were able to claim money, the Indian shareholders were not. There was no class action suit that was there. So 245 is an example where you gave certain class of shareholders to have a claim against not just the company, but again people who are associated with the company. So probably a law firm, say, for example, where you can have a claim against those entities associated with the company. Provisions like related party transactions is one of the takeaways from RPTs or duties of directors or intercorporate loans or intercorporate deposits, is we realizing the fact that we are so promoter-centric companies that we have to take steps to prevent or to make transaction happen on arm's length basis and to avoid conflict of interest as far as possible. Because unlike US, where there's a difference between management and ownership, both are intertwined into one in the Indian listed company. We saw the ownership pattern. So while on the broader principles we might converge, you will find larger divergences happening around the issues that mar the Indian specific to Indian context. Anything else? Enlightened shareholders' value is basically saying, it's basically saying that all you do, basically, the company's prime objective is to enhance the value of the shareholders. It sees companies as a nexus of contracts. It sees all actions of the company in a context where it should enhance or increase the interest of the shareholders who are there. And when you do that, other stakeholders will derive their interest from that only. So the prime objective is shareholders' value. Others are subservient. So basically, others will derive its interest from that. Stakeholders is seeing all of them as equal stakeholders. Yes, please. Jurisdiction of?
We were discussing with Professor Harris, where companies have the option to incorporate in so many jurisdictions. Is there truly something unique which India offers which might incentivize companies?
All right, so one part of the discussion was with respect to states in US, right? So Delaware, say, for example, which sees the maximum number of incorporation because Delaware law was created in that context. If you see Atlanta laws to these days, they have been gearing towards inviting more and more companies. So they have the flexibility to do that in terms of state-wise laws. India does not have that, firstly. So we do not have state-wise laws on corporation law. We have a Unified Companies Act. Now, in terms of jurisdictional competition on a country level, say, for example, now, we have to understand, and I'm a strong proponent of the fact of a cautioned approach. In the sense, we are placed in a situation where we do not have the liberty or we cannot afford to create a system which is mimicking the developed nations. As it is, and that is where the answer is also coming. No, we do not provide any flexibility to the companies to incorporate in India, which is in competition to say US or UK or other jurisdictions. Reason we do not do that, because we see regulations or laws as protection mechanism. All right. So till the time, again, and I'm talking especially in context to capital market, we are still in a situation where less than 1% or 2% of the population invest in capital market, which basically means the financial literacy has not percolated in wider mass. So our regulations or laws will be protective in nature. because we do not want, as we want those events not to happen, but again, we do not want Indian capital market to be again faced with situations after situation which reduces that public trust, right? So if you see ICDR or LODR, the feedback that you get from companies is basically on the front of the number of compliances that they have to do, filings that they have to do. But again, you can condense that, but I'll see more them as a precautionary measure rather than facilitating measure. As soon as we reach a stage where we find the jurisdiction of the capital market reaching to a stage where we can progress from a precautionary or a cautionary jurisdiction to a facilitating jurisdiction, probably then. Say, for example, what is ease of doing business? Ease of doing business is asking companies to basically register, right? The propensity of the companies doing their activities in terms of registration part is one of those parts, right? So the quickness of registration is one of the parts of ease of doing business. But we fare quite low in the ease of doing business, right? Now, it can happen because of adjoining laws that are, again, more precautionary than the capital market regulation itself. So you will find, say, for example, the insurance laws or the banking laws even stricter than capital market regulations. I have not a clear cut answer to that. So in terms of facilitating, we do not, in fact, we will rank low in facilitating companies to come to Indian jurisdiction, because we will, at present state, we will probably not be able to look beyond the precautionary or the boundaries that we have created around, right? Multiple, you can talk about multiple issues and you will find a more cautioned approach by both SEBI and RBI, whether it's capital market securities, whether it's allowing of, say, cryptocurrency that we started talked about in the class, RBI. So now, again, I'm more into context of a precautionary approach, but I'm also not saying put up a blind eye, right? So in terms of cryptocurrencies, if you see, there are jurisdictions which have recognized the fact that cryptocurrencies are real. They are crypto in their nature, but their existence is real. So it's better we recognize that fact, and it's better we create a structure around it. Indian jurisdiction, on the other hand, SEBI is still struggling on the fact of whether we have the jurisdiction or not. RBI is also struggling on the whether we have the jurisdiction or not. So, and we do not see something that is coming from the government itself. So each regulator is trying to put a blindfold in terms of cryptocurrencies. I'm not in favor of that. But in terms of opening of the market to certain context, it's better we have a precautionary approach rather than something like US happens again here. Imagine that. All right.
Sir, my question is at more jurisprudential level and not at legal level.
Right.
I have a very basic and fundamental question. Like any country, while formulating policies or law for that matter, they have different set of priorities in their own minds. Say, for example, before 1991, India, as a socialist country, was not ready to give free hand to these giant market players. But do you think the idea of a socialist nation or socialist policy is actually in conflict with the free market policy? Or do you think that at some level they actually merge or they go hand in hand? How do you think that a country should approach while framing the law or legislation, and how to balance these two
big
agendas?
Big question to answer here. How to balance? Again, we have been struggling to find that balance for the last 70 years. So I will not be able to answer that in 2 minutes. How do we find that balance? But again, see, 1990, what happened post 1990 is seen more as a part of a compulsion rather than our choice, right? So we had to open up the market. We were following a certain ideological agenda throughout, but 1990 basically asked our markets to be opened up in a certain manner, and that is why, to answer to those new market realities, we have to create other structures around. Now, If you see, say, for example, most of these regulators, and I'll just answer that on that front. I'm not sure whether I'll be able to elaborate more further on that. If you see SEBI, say, for example, if you see Competition Commission, say, for example, if you read the preamble or that of these statutes, what's the preamble of SEBI? It says, what's the preamble? Investor protection, development, and regulation of capital market or securities market. If you see Competition Act, consumer protection is one of the primates. So consumer interest, protection of competition in the market is a prime agenda that has been taken into account. So while we have created regulators or statutory bodies, we have not left out the prime objective of in the sense of investor protection, we have not left out the prime stakeholders. So we have created wide provisions in all these statutory legislation, say, for example, where we try to strike that balance of these regulators taking into account those broad objectives in mind. So I don't know if I've answered your question, but if anyone else probably wants to answer that question. Anyone? Right. All right, so we are at the end of our sessions. I will not go and ask what you learned from the entire course. Again, like our class, it's very difficult to find that how and what you learned. But again, if you look at, I'm not sure whether how many of you have gone through the readings of Professor Harris. But if you do, if you go beyond the reading that was assigned to you, at least go through those readings which are contemporary, in the sense which are say post 1900s. You'll find a large number of those articles indicating towards theories which affect present context. So if you find time, all those are fascinating readings. I've shared all those readings with you in terms of Google Drive. Please store that in your laptop whenever you have time again. Probably you can read those. Read my article obviously also. These are fairly simple articles with respect to transplant, with respect to convergence and divergence. So small formality details. Sunday is your last date for submission of your second assignment. I hope I have received all the first assignment in my mailbox. For outstation students, you will receive your certificates as soon as we get the results. Right? So do not expect it to be before the, by the end, till the end of this month. Right? If you pass, you will know. If you fail, you will know. Right? Apart from that, thank you very much. Attendance is left. 21. Okay. All right, before I forget, students from my capital market class, right, all those who have presentation on stockbrokers tomorrow, please be ready for it. Some students have their presentations, right, stockbrokers.